Thank you very much. Thank you for your very nice introduction. I'm very happy for being here today. And for this reason, I would like to thank the organizing committee for inviting me. And I'm a microbiologist, and I have been working on lactic acid bacteria and probiotics, and I study on their metabolism and physiology. And we have been working in our lab with flow cytometry since 2014, so just 5 years. But I like very much flow cytometry. I like very much working with flow cytometer. And so I think that with this presentation, I'm going to give you, I hope, to give you a different point of view of the utilization of the flow cytometry. And flow cytometry can find applications in general in microbiology, in a different field of the microbiology. For example, for the quantification of bacteria in a soil sample, or again in aquatic microbiology. For example, in Swiss, the flow cytometer is used for the continuous microbiological check of the tap water. And then for example, flow virometry for the measurement for the detection of viral particles in a sample. And so besides food microbiology, we have many different applications of flow cytometry in microbiology. But I'm here to talk to you about our applications in food microbiology and why we use flow cytometry to do what? For example, for the cell counting and to assess the viability of a sample of bacteria, or again to study on cell physiology and cell-to-cell metabolic interaction, to assess the sensitivity of bacteria to toxic compounds or to new antimicrobials, or to check the quality of probiotic formulations that are usually sell in and maybe all of us are consumer of these probiotic products, and finally to set up a new protocol for a new strain isolation. So let's start with the first application. So to count cells in suspension and to assess their viability. In 2015, the International Organization for Standardization and the International Dairy Federation suggested the flow cytometry as a technique to assess, to count cells in milk and milk products, to assess, to quantify starter culture and probiotics in fermented products. In this protocol, they suggest simultaneously the double staining of the cells, and this double staining is made with Cyto24, that it has a fluorescence in the green channel FL1, and is able to stain all the cells present in our suspension. So Cyto24 allows us to selectively count only cells and not the background. Okay, that does not contain DNA. Cyto24 can bind and can attach the double strand of the DNA. So only cells has the DNA. So we can distinguish background from the cells. And the second stain is the propidium iodide. Propidium iodide has a fluorescence in the red channel and is able to enter only into the cells with a damaged membrane or in dead cells. Okay, so if we stain our cell suspension simultaneously with these two staining, we can get at the end three different populations in terms of fluorescence. The first population is the population in the gate green, that is the population of active fluorescent unit that encompasses the alive cells. And this population displays only a green fluorescence due to the presence of the Cyto24 inside to the cells. The second population is considered of the population of damaged cells with the damaged membrane. And inside this gate, we have those cells with green fluorescence and red fluorescence due to the presence simultaneously of Cyto24 and propidium iodide. And then we have the third population that is called non-active fluorescent unit that encompasses those cells that are considered as dead. Because inside of these events, inside of these cells, we have of course Cyto24 because it's able to enter into all the cells of our sample, but we have a huge amount, a large amount of propidium iodide that can mask the fluorescence of the Cyto24. So, three different populations, and we have assessed the viability of our cell suspension. That it's fine if we are analyzing, for example, a probiotic that contains only one species, but in our case, we have a multi-species probiotic formulation. And for example, in this formulation, we have seven different bacterial species. For example, we have Streptococcus thermophilus, we have Bifidobacterium bifidum, we have Bifidobacterium longum, Lactobacillus paracasei, and so on. So seven different species. So at the end of this analysis,
how do you do the staining of these samples to distinguish between the populations?
How? Yeah. In MRD. You mean the
yeah,
which?
Because, for example, you distinguish like the transition, let's say the damaged population.
So is this population?
Yes.
Okay.
Do you
the staining.
No.
I have just to assess the state, the physiological state, the viability of my suspension.
Okay.
Okay. So the staining where is done in the MRD according to the ISO 19344 protocol, okay? But we are working on this buffer because it's not the ideal buffer to check to assess the viability of the strain, but this is another topic, okay? So we are in presence of seven different species, so I cannot say this dot, for example, to which species correspond. Okay, we cannot give a name of all the dot in this gate and the dot of damaged cells, so we do not have the relative abundance of each species in each of these three gates. Okay, so why? Because the flow cytometer is not a taxonomic approach. So I can just assess, I can just see that I have cells, but I cannot give a name to this dot, I cannot give a name to all these events, because it's not a taxonomic approach. So how can we overcome this limit of the flow cytometry? We use the fluorescent active cell sorter, and basically we selectively sort these two populations, the live cells belonging to group A, the live cells belonging to group B that are different based on their different green fluorescence, okay, and then we sort the population of the dead cells. And these three images are just the check after the sorting of these three different populations. And as you can see, the live cells of group A fit perfectly in the gate that we expect. And the live cells of group B fit in the correct gate, in the green gate. But the dead cells does not fit in the red gate as we expect. Why? Because the sorting procedure takes, in this case, more or less, more than 4 or 5 hours. So maybe during the procedure, the cells lose the fluorescence, the red fluorescence, okay? And so once we got these three different populations in three different tubes, we proceeded with the DNA extraction and the qPCR for the quantification of the relative abundance of each species. How? By qPCR, so a molecular approach, because we made primers for the selective detection of each species inside this probiotic formulation. And the results are quite clear, because we can find, so here I list the seven species that we have in this probiotic formulation, And beside the name of the species of these formulations, because this is just an example for you, the species 1 is present in all the 3 populations, as expected, because in my probiotic formulation, I have, for the species 1, alive cells and even dead cells. So, the first take-home message is that with flow cytometry, we can assess, we can count the cells in suspension, we can assess their viability, and although it's not a taxonomic approach, we can overcome this issue by approaching other techniques, okay? The second kind of experiment that we did by using flow cytometry to study in particular cell physiology and to study cell-to-cell interactions. Here I report the 2 bacteria that are used for the production of yogurt. So we name yogurt consortium those bacteria that are used for the production of this fermented milk. And in particular the name is of these cocci is Streptococcus thermophilus, and these roads are Lactobacillus delbrueckii bulgaricus. And the relationship between these 2 bacterial species is well known and well characterized, and the name of this cooperation, this relationship, is proto-cooperation. Why? Because this proto-cooperation is basically an exchange of nutrients between the 2 bacterial species during the yogurt production. In particular, Lactobacillus delbrueckii bulgaricus provide to Streptococcus thermophilus amino acids. Why? Because a Streptococcus, in general, strains belonging to Streptococcus thermophilus species are a very feeble proteolytic activity, so they need amino acids for the growth of the cells, and these amino acids come, for example, from Lactobacillus delbrueckii bulgaricus. And Streptococcus thermophilus, conversely, Streptococcus thermophilus provide other nutrients to Lactobacillus delbrueckii bulgaricus. Okay? And Streptococcus thermophilus is the only lactic acid bacterium of dairy industry displaying urease activity. Urea is normally present in milk, and during its growth, Streptococcus thermophilus can hydrolyze the urea present in milk, and with the consequent release of carbon dioxide, that is one of the nutrients that Streptococcus thermophilus provides to Lactobacillus bulgaricus in the first phase of the yogurt production. And the second product of the urea hydrolysis is ammonia. And as you can imagine, the release of ammonia can modulate intracellular pH of Streptococcus thermophilus, can increase the intracellular pH of Streptococcus thermophilus. And we know that this increase of its intracellular pH can positively affect the activity of the metabolic enzymes of Streptococcus thermophilus. So, in presence of urease activity, we have a boost of the energetic metabolism of Streptococcus thermophilus due to this modulation of intracellular pH. And so our question is it possible that ammonia that comes from the urea hydrolysis can modify the intracellular pH of a urease negative like Lactobacillus delbrueckii bulgaricus that share the same environment of Streptococcus thermophilus, that's milk, during milk acidification in yogurt production? So this was our hypothesis. And how to measure the intracellular pH of bacterial cells? We used carboxyfluoresein diacetate N-succinyl ester. That is a non-fluorescent molecule, but once inside the cells, is cleaved by intracellular esterase, and the product is the carboxyfluoresein, is a fluorescent molecule, and the fluorescence of this molecule is affected by intracellular pH of the cells. So we have a high level of fluorescence in presence of high pH values. And the fluorescence of the carboxyfluorescein decrease during milk acidification, during the acidification of the intracellular pH of the cells. So let's see if it's possible to see, first of all, the modulation of the intracellular pH of Streptococcus thermophilus during urea hydrolysis. So here we have, in this graph, we have the forward scatter, that is a parameter related to the morphological characteristic of the cells. And here we have the fluorescence of the carboxyfluorescein. This is the time zero, and we measured the intracellular pH and extracellular pH, okay, before the addition of or ammonia or urea, so an alkalizing agents. Okay, so I expect now a question. And I expect that maybe you are wondering how we can measure the intracellular pH. How it's possible to correspond a fluorescence value with an intracellular pH? Do you have an idea?
Maybe with some known control?
Yes,
maybe
and
standard
not.
Curve?
Yes, that's perfect. With a standard curve, by using labeled cells with carboxyfluorescein, and we put these cells in buffer at a different pH, from 4 up to 8. Okay, and so we got a particular fluorescence for a particular pH. So with a standard curve, we could determine the intracellular pH, of course. And what happens immediately after the addition of ammonia, or after just 5 minutes after the addition of urea, we have a shift of the fluorescence of our population. That means that urea was hydrolyzed. And we have an increase of the extracellular pH, of course, because the ammonia is then released in our buffer, in a saline solution. And we have also an increase of the intracellular pH. What happens if I do not add an alkalizing agent? The system is quite stable. And this is another way to see these results. So the shift on the right of the fluorescence means an higher fluorescence after the addition of ammonia or urea. So we are able to measure this shift of fluorescence. We are able to measure the changing in intracellular pH in Streptococcus thermophilus during urease activity. And then, of course, if you remember, our question was if the urease activity and ammonia that comes from urea hydrolysis can affect the intracellular pH of Lactobacillus delbrueckii bulgaricus, that is a urease negative species. Okay? And in this case, we used Streptococcus thermophilus, that is in this gate, not labeled with carboxyfluorescein, so unstained Streptococcus thermophilus, and we used Lactobacillus delbrueckii bulgaricus stained with carboxyfluorescein. So this is our time zero. This is our intracellular pH at time zero of Lactobacillus delbrueckii bulgaricus. And what happens after a few minutes after the addition of urea that is hydrolyzed by Streptococcus thermophilus? As you can see, we have a shift of the fluorescence of Lactobacillus delbrueckii bulgaricus. It means that the ammonia that comes from urea hydrolysis can affect the intracellular pH of a urease negative species present in the same environment of a urease positive microorganism. And as you can see, we have a shift because during the procedure, the cells that were unstained of Streptococcus thermophilus at the end a fluorescence, a green fluorescence due to the staining of carboxyfluorescein, maybe because a washing step or because there was again carboxyfluorescein free in our supernatant. But of course this does not affect what we would see, okay, that was this modulation of the intracellular pH of Lactobacillus Brucki bulgaricus. And this is the control without urea. So the system is quite stable. And finally, by flow cytometer, we were able to measure the intracellular pH of Streptococcus thermophilus during its growth in milk. In particular, these cells were in milk. Okay, and in this case, I report the trend of the intracellular pH of Streptococcus thermophilus and the trend of the extracellular pH. Control condition without addition of any alkalizing agents, or after the addition of urea, and as you can see, we have a slight modulation of the intracellular pH followed by a decrease of the intracellular pH. And the extracellular pH was quite stable because we are in milk and the milk is a buffered system. And what happens if I add ammonia? Of course, the modulation of the intracellular pH of Streptococcus thermophilus is faster when I add ammonia because we do not have to wait the enzymatic activity of the urease and the hydrolysis of urea. And in this case, we observed an increase, immediate increase of the intracellular pH of Streptococcus thermophilus cells followed by an acidification. What does it mean, this acidification that we can see in particular after the addition of urea or ammonia? That the energetic metabolism of Streptococcus thermophilus is strongly active because Streptococcus thermophilus has a very simple energetic metabolism based on the glycolytic enzymes, and the last step is the production of the conversion of pyruvate into lactic acid, that is the base of the production of the yogurt, of course. So after the addition of urea, we can produce more lactic acid. Indeed, if in only 15 minutes of incubation at 37 degrees, at the end you measure the lactic acid concentration in these three conditions, as you can see, we have more lactic acid in presence of an alkalizing agent. So it seems that if we want to acidify, we have to alkalize our system, okay? Because the glycolytic enzyme of Streptococcus thermophilus, but not only, the glycolytic enzyme of Lactobacillus de Brucki as well, have an optimum pH for their activity at alkaline values. So during their growth, usually, they acidify the intracellular pH. So when the intracellular pH is around 5.5, they stop their growth. So the urease activity in Streptococcus thermophilus allows to the cells to increase their fitness during its growth in milk. And the same for Lactobacillus del Brucki bulgaricus. Of course, it's an urease negative species, but we have ammonia. And even in this case, in presence of an alkalizing agent, we were able to detect a higher amount of lactic acid produced, keep in mind, in only 15 minutes of incubation. Okay, let's, please.
Si. If you have an accidental acidification of your yogurt, so the production, so you stop the production of yogurt.
No, but it's normal, because we want the acidification of the milk to arrive at the final product, that is a yogurt, okay? But, no, maybe I didn't get.
Because you add ammonia to
produce yogurt. No, to produce yogurt, no. But the urea is normally present in milk. Okay, so Streptococcus thermophilus can find urea in milk. Okay. Let's move to the another applications of flow cytometry. and in this case to assess cell sensitivity to toxic compounds or to test new antimicrobials. And I list here several examples. For example, we use Streptococcus thermophilus, that is my favorite species, because my PhD thesis was focused on Streptococcus thermophilus. I love it. And then to assess, to characterize an efflux pump of Streptococcus thermophilus, and then sensitivity of Listeria monocytogenes against essential oils, and to assess the mechanism of action of promethazine, and finally to assess the sensitivity of foodborne pathogens, especially Listeria monocytogenes, against resveratrol-derived monomers and dimers. So let's start with the characterization of the efflux pump of Streptococcus thermophilus. The efflux pump are spread in eukaryotic and prokaryotic cells. And just to give you an example, efflux pump are involved sometimes in antibiotic resistance phenomena, or maybe in the resistance of cancer cells to chemotherapy, for example. Because once an efflux pump finds something that could be cytotoxic for the cells, is able to pump out from inside to outside the cells to protect the cells, okay? And ethidium bromide, that is a cytotoxic compound, but it is fluorescence, it is used to characterize the activity of efflux pump in general. And so we used ethidium bromide to assess the activity of PMRB, that is an efflux pump of Streptococcus thermophilus. So we stain, we load cells with ethidium bromide, that is on this axis, and it has red fluorescence, and we stain simultaneously cells with cybergreen, just to have a double check of that what we were counting were cells, okay? Because once the ethidium bromide is pumped out from the cells, then we cannot say if an event is a cell or not. Okay, so the double staining with ethidium bromide and cybergreen. And after the staining, we provide to the cells lactose, because this is the favorite sugar that is used by Streptococcus thermophilus. Why we have to provide a sugar to the cells? Because these efflux pump work usually with ATP consumption, so cells to efflux from to extrude ethidium bromide, they need energy, so ATP, so a sugar. And what happens after 30 minutes of incubation? As you can see, we have a shift on the left, so a decrease of the presence of the ethidium bromide inside the cells because the activity of this efflux pump. To better characterize the activity of this efflux pump, we try to make the overexpression of this efflux pump PMRB. And this is the mutant with the empty vector. And as you can see, the wild type with the empty vector is able to pump out ethidium bromide. Okay? But we have always two subpopulations. Okay? What happens after the overexpression of PMRB? So in MIM27, this is the mutant with the overexpression of this efflux pump. At the end of our assay, we have just one population. So it seems that in our wild type population, we have two subpopulations with different activity in terms of this efflux pump. And the reason can be two. Okay, the first one, maybe in this population we have a higher overexpression of this efflux pump, but we do not know. Or the second reason, that for some reason in this population we have a higher activity. but please consider higher activity of this efflux pump, but please consider that the genetic background of this population is homogeneous. So we do not expect such a kind of phenotypic heterogeneity. And then we test, as I told you, Listeria monocytogenes against essential oil. You know that Listeria monocytogenes is a foodborne pathogen that is ubiquitous in nature. And we know that Listeria monocytogenes is sensitive to the treatment with essential oils. So we try to combine the treatment with essential oils, in particular thymol, thymol and carbacrol. We combine this treatment with a mild heat treatment at 50 or 55 degrees. And what happens? I think that these images are quite funny because, look, these are the cells of Listeria monocytogenes after the treatment at 50 degrees without essential oils. Okay? And this is after 55 degrees treatment. Here we stain cells with cybergreen and propidium iodide. So again, we have three different populations, alive, injured, and dead cells. Okay, what happens when this mild heat treatment is combined in presence of essential oils? Please look at 50 degrees. You can see the shift of our population to the injured gate and dead gate. And let's see what happens at 55 degrees. So here, in presence of thymol. And then again, let's go to the 50 degrees in presence of carbacrol, that is more active than thymol. And what happens at 55 degrees in presence of carbacrol? And then we try to combine mild heat treatment and both essential oils together. Let's take a look at 50 degrees and 55 degrees. Okay, so this is just to monitor the viability of the cells after a treatment. Okay, in parallel, we measured by using propidium iodide the damages at the level of the membrane. And as you can see, we have an increase of the trend of the fluorescence of propidium iodide when we use essential oils, both at 50 or 55 degrees. And in parallel, we measured the cell membrane potential of Listeria monocytogenes. The cell membrane potential is essential for live cells. Okay, and what happens during the treatment? As you can see here, we used the debulk staining, and the increase of the fluorescence reflects a decrease of the membrane potential of the cells. So we are in presence after heat treatment or heat treatment plus essential oils, we are in presence of a depolarized membrane that is not compatible with the life of the cells. But interestingly, after the treatment at 50 degrees without essential oils, we have at the end of this procedure, most of the cells, around 92% after 50 degrees treatment, and 76% after 55 degrees treatment. Most of the cells remains alive, but none of these cells are still culturable. So, two different concepts, viability and culturability. In microbiology, these are two completely concepts, okay? Viability is what we assess by flow cytometry. Culturability is what we assess by dilution and plating on a selective media, on a media that is good for the growth of Listeria monocytogenes. But although most of the cells were alive, these cells were no longer culturable. Okay? And this state is known as a viable but not culturable state. That, of course, is very dangerous because if you make a quality control of food and you exclude by dilution and plating the presence, you can exclude by dilution and plating the presence of Listeria monocytogenes, this is not completely true. Okay?
Sorry, if I mean, this state is reversible, it means you say it's dangerous. So you cannot catch the presence because they are not
exactly
culturable, but, which I understand is a problem, but is this state of alive but not culturable reversible to?
Yes, of course, and we call about resuscitation of these cells. This is the problem, but still, no, you are right. Thank you for your question. And this is the big problem, because still we do not know how these cells can resuscitate. Okay, still we do not know. Sometimes you think that maybe if I add some nutrients, maybe then I can get the resuscitation of the cells. This is not true. It seems that the worst condition allow to these cells to resuscitate. It's quite strange, but still we are studying this state. That is the escape of bacterial cells in presence, for example, of an antibiotic. Okay. And because if the cells stop to duplicate, maybe they are not the target of the antibiotic. And so once the antibiotic is no longer present, these cells can duplicate again. And this is the main problem. I'm really very interesting about this state, but it's quite difficult. And as I told you, the problem of these cells that these cells are alive and metabolically active. For this reason, they are very dangerous. Okay, and this viable but not culturable state is induced by chemical treatment, heat shock, like in our case, or by the presence of antimicrobials, for example. Promethazine is an antimicrobial, is an antibiotic that is produced by Pseudomonas putida. And this is an antibiotic that is active against gram-positive and gram-negative bacteria. And so could you mind which kind of bacteria we use for such a kind of assay to test the activity of promethazine against 1 gram-positive bacteria? We used, of course, Streptococcus thermophilus. No, because it's easy to grow. It grow faster, and of course it's not a pathogenic bacteria. Okay, so it's a model for us, like E. coli for other research group, no? And the staining, double staining, cybergreen and propidium iodide, and this is the time zero, and this is after addition of 30 minutes after the addition of promethazine. You can see the evolution of the viability of our cells. And this is after 60 minutes. And in this assay, we used as a reference molecule the chlorhexidine, that is a well-known biocide that has as a target the cell membrane of bacteria. And by flow cytometry, we assessed which part of our promethazine is essential for its activity. So in collaboration with the chemistry department of University of Milan, they remove the part of the molecule. And for example, in this case, as you can see in the molecule number 5, we miss all this part of the molecule. And if we cut this part of the molecule, then promethazine is no longer active against Streptococcus thermophilus. So in this way, we assess the effect of the exposition of promethazine and which part of the molecule is essential for its activity, its antibacterial activity. And here we have the example of Listeria monocytogenes treated in presence of a molecule that we call 15, that is a dimer derived from resveratrol. And resveratrol belongs to secondary metabolites of the plant, and the plant can produce such a kind of metabolites after abiotic stress. So if the plants produce such a kind of molecule after the attack of fungi, virus, or bacteria, the idea is to test such a kind of secondary metabolite like resveratrol to understand if we can find new antimicrobial. As you can see, one of the main problems nowadays is the emergence of the antibiotic resistance. So it's essential to find new antimicrobials, okay? And, okay, in this case we have control cells. We exposed Listeria monocytogenes to 10 microgram ml or 100 microgram ml of these dimer derived from resveratrol. And as you can see, we have, of course, a strong effect of this molecule. Please consider that this exposition is of not more than 30 minutes. Okay, so in 30 minutes, this molecule is able to kill all the cells of Listeria monocytogenes. And as a reference, we used, again, chlorhexidine.
The MSO is vehicle control or?
The MSO, because it's a control, it is the second control because this molecule is resuspended in the MSO. So we used the same amount, okay, just to check that the effect was not of because of the presence of the MSO. Please. No, not exactly. No, not yet with this molecule. Not yet. In parallel, we measured the cell membrane potential. And as you can see, these are the control cells or cells in presence of the MSO, so no effect on cell membrane potential. But we use a DOC that has a green fluorescence usually. But once inside the cells, in presence of a large membrane potential, so when we are in presence of active cells, the fluorescence of the DOC has a shift into the red channel, into the red fluorescence. So in this case, what we have to consider to understand if our molecule can affect the membrane potential is this ratio, green fluorescent, red fluorescent. Because in presence of a large membrane potential, we have a high red fluorescence. In presence of a depolarized membrane, we have a decrease of this red fluorescence that reflects this ratio. So in presence of our antimicrobials, and we use gramicidine, that is an antibiotic that a mix of three different antibiotics and gramicidine can act against the cell membrane of bacteria. As you can see, in presence of even small amount, 10 microgram per ml of our dimer of resveratrol, we have a depolarization of our cell membrane. Although the viability was not so affected. So it seems that the first target of this molecule is the cell membrane, but the first effect of the cell on the cell membrane is the depolarization of the potential of the membrane, okay? And then damages of the membrane. And we confirm this data by using transmission electron microscope analysis. And as you can see, after the exposition of Listeria monocytogenes cells, we have an extrusion, we have a release of the intracellular content of the cells. And this can reflect damages at the level of the cell membrane. Okay, let's move to another application. And this is flow cytometry to check to control multi-strain probiotic formulation. Again, the probiotic formulation that contains seven different bacterial species. And a multi-strain probiotic formulation should be taxonomically defined. What does it mean? That inside my formulation, I have to find only those bacterial species that are listed on my box, okay, and nothing else, not other contaminants, for example. And should have a reproducible composition, of course. Variation between one lot and one another are not acceptable. And be safe, of course. The microorganisms inside should not carry antibiotic resistance genes, of course. Should contain viable cells. This is the only and the first claim of a probiotic formulation. So viable cells are essential for their activity. And finally, be controlled for probiotic molecular markers. And in our formulation, we have Streptococcus thermophilus that has urease activity. So we can check, we can stain our probiotic formulation with the carboxylic fluoresein. And as you can see, we have a shift from G1 to G2 of the population that probably is the population of Streptococcus thermophilus cells that are able to hydrolyze urea. And what else? At the time zero, after the staining with the carboxyfluoresein, we have two different fluorescence. We have the gate that encompasses these cells with low fluorescence that we can consider low active cells. Why? Because the fluorescence that we can measure is dependent on the esterase activity of the cells. For this reason, we talk about low active cells. And we have a gate that encompasses high active cells with a higher fluorescence. We sort selectively these two populations, and then DNA extraction and qPCR. And as you can see, we have the species number one present in low active cells and even in high active cells, and the same for all the other species. It means that in our probiotic formulation, we have cells belonging to the same species, but in different physiological state. What does it mean for Streptococcus thermophilus being in a different physiological state? Look at this. For example, Streptococcus thermophilus grows in a chain of two, three, or even more cells. And in this chain, we have brighter cells, so high active cells, and we have cells with a very low fluorescence of the carboxyfluoresein, so low fluorescence, low active cells, in the same chain. And please keep in mind that a chain is the product of the replication of one cell, the same cell. And finally, the last application, to develop new protocol for strains isolation. We are interested in the last period to isolate new bacteria, especially new lactobacillus species, from in order to use these new strain for as probiotic for the vaginal tract. Lactobacillus is really abundant in a vaginal tract of healthy women. So we have two different choices. We can proceed by dilution and plating, okay, of a vaginal swab of healthy women. Dilution and plating, that of course is time consuming, and you need to prepare the media, you need to make several dilutions, and once you have the growth of your cells, you have to streak again each single colony in order to have a pure culture of your new isolate. Or we can use the fluorescent active cell sorter. So we collect a vaginal swab of a healthy woman, and we stain only with cybergreen and not with Cyto24 or propidium iodide, because they are strongly toxic for the cells. And we need alive cells, so we cannot affect the viability of our cell suspension. Okay? So we stain only with cybergreen, and then we spot each single cell on agar plate. Okay? And of course, where you have the plus, it means that we didn't get the growth. Because, of course, when you spot one single cell, not all the cells that you spot are still live, okay, or able to form colonies, to give rise to colony on agar plate. But And as you can see in the red circle, is quite easy to distinguish in this plate at least four different morphologies. And these colonies come from the replication of a single cell. So we have already a pure culture. So just to conclude, please.
Pure meaning genetically homogeneous?
Pure mean genetically homogeneous, yes, and not phenotypic, because as we saw, we can have an homogeneous background, a homogeneous genetic background, the phenotypic heterogeneity is not controlled, of course. So just some pros and cons about flow cytometry in microbiology. Of course, it's a rapid analysis because in less than half an hour you can assess the viability of your cell suspension. Accuracy, the standard deviation is less than 5%. Dilution and plating has a standard deviation that is around 20%. And of course, you can generate multi-parameters. Why? Because once you have your cell suspension, you can analyze the forward scatter, the side scatter, the primary fluorescence. This primary fluorescence is the autofluorescence of a sample. For example, in yeast, the autofluorescence of the yeast depends on the metabolic activity of the yeast, respiratory metabolism, fermentative metabolism, the state of the cytochrome oxidase in a reduced form or in a oxidized form. So this is the primary fluorescence that is very useful and informative. Then, of course, we have the secondary fluorescence. Please keep in mind that we have a very, very long list of fluorescent molecules. I think that I know just a very small part of this list. Okay, with a large number of applications, for example, for ATP production, sugar transport, oxidative stress, and so on. And it's easy to obtain statistical relevant data set because, of course, for each analysis, you can run more than 100,000 cells per minute, for example. Okay? And again, microbial cells can be detected irrespective of their cultivability, as we saw for Listeria monocytogenes, for example. And especially, we are able, by flow cytometry, to make an analysis at single cell level, to unveil the heterogenic phenotypicity of a homogeneous population in terms of genetic background. The cons is probably that flow cytometry is not a taxonomic approach, but we saw that it's possible to overcome this problem, this issue. I think that you can ask me, why don't you use antibodies? Because they are expensive and we cannot use antibodies. And so this is the main problem. And because there are not so many antibodies available ready for all the species that we are going to test. So thanks again for being here, for your attention.